Hey, what's up? I'm DJ Sixsmith. You're watching The Sit Down. Time to talk with a Hollywood legend about his brand new book. It's Magic Time, Hawk Koch. How are you, man?
How are you, DJ?
Good to meet you. How's
nice
everything
going? Nice to meet you. I'm having a good time. I've always been a movie producer, and now I'm an author. I don't know what that is. I'm just learning.
Did you ever think you'd be an author?
No. No. I gave a commencement address at a film school back in California, and everybody said they were so inspired, and I thought, oh, that might be fun to do, because I love mentoring, and I love young people who all want to be filmmakers. And so I went and got an agent and said, hey, I want, you know, can you get me speaking gigs? And they said, have you got a book? And I said, no.
Like, let me get on that real quick.
Yeah, so 4 years later, we have a book.
Wow, that's awesome. So you have like a ton of stuff to go through in your life and your career, but I think Magic Time is probably a good place to start with the title. Right. And even with your name itself, what was it like unpacking things about you personally that you hadn't really thought about necessarily?
Well, for years I've been telling stories about movies that I've been on and actors, directors, etc. And everybody says you've got to write a book and put these stories down. And I thought, you know what? Just a series of stories about movies isn't enough to write to get everybody interested. But I did have a really interesting father-son relationship and how I had to cut out from under the shadow of a very, very well-loved man in Hollywood. He was known as the most well-loved man in Hollywood. And he gave me the same name, so I was Howard W. Koch Jr. and he was Howard W. Koch Sr., so wherever I went, if I met somebody, they wouldn't say, hi, how are you, what do you do, or whatever normally you and I would do. They'd go, oh, I love your father. You know, he's the most wonderful man. You know, he gave me my first job, or he helped my cousin or my sister or my brother or my son. Please say hi to him for me. And they never talked to me.
Right, they never asked anything about you.
Not asked about me.
Yeah.
And I've done a lot, from AD on some great movies, Chinatown, Marathon Man,
The Way We Were.
Yeah, but everybody always said, you know, please say hi to your dad. So when I was 49, I had just gone through a relationship. I've had several relationships in my life. Got three great kids. I've got five grandsons. But when I was 49, I wanted to do something spiritual for my 50th birthday. And a good Catholic friend of mine said, listen, I know you were never bar mitzvahed, and you have three kids, and I've been to all their bar and bar mitzvahs. And, you know, can you get bar mitzvahed at 50? And I went, wow, what a cool idea. What a great thing to do. I don't know if I can. So I found a rabbi who taught Kabbalah and Hebrew meditation. And we sat and talked for about a half hour, and then he asked, who are you? And I said, oh, I'm a movie producer. And he said, no, 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 who are you?
Exactly.
And I said, oh, I'm a father and I'm a son. He got mad. He said, who are you? And man, I didn't know who I was. And I, for some reason, blurted out, I'm a Jewish man. And he said, oh, well, that's a start. He said, what's your Hebrew name? And every Jew is supposed to be given a Hebrew name as well as a Christian name when they're born. And I said, my parents are non-religious. I never had a Hebrew name. And he said, well, for your 50th birthday, for your bar mitzvah, you'll be given your own name. I broke down. And he said, what's wrong? And I said, I just realized for 49 years, I've had my father's name. I'd like to have my own name. And then he said the thing that changed my life. A rabbi said, well, you can have your own name. What? What, I can have my own name?
Advice for 49 years.
Yeah, right. Why didn't I think of this and why didn't? So we talked about, do you want to be known as DJ or Frank or Harry or Mary or whatever? And I said, no. And he said, did you ever have a nickname? And I said, well, my initials are H-W-K.
Hawk.
A few people called me Hawk, but it didn't really stick. And he said, well, do you know anything about hawks? And I said, yeah, bird of prey. And he said, yeah, well, they mate for life. And that was something I was not very good at.
A little bit the opposite.
Yes, right. And he said, they also can see from horizon to horizon. And they can see like a rabbit a half a mile away. Wouldn't it be great if you could see the panoramic of your life and the detail always at the same time? And I thought, wow, that's really cool, but isn't a hawk kind of a pretentious name? And he said, only if you allow it to be. So at 50 years old, I'd run a production company, I'd produced movies, I'd done all this stuff, and I had a lot of friends. Are they all going to tell me that I'm an idiot? You know, am I on acid or something?
Right.
I mean, you know. But I went up to Telluride, Colorado, just to kind of think it through, and there was a Native American there who was selling kind of trinkets. And it's a lightning bolt, a cloud, and the word listen.
Wow.
And I said, what does it mean? And he said, do you know the way we are awake and aware and attuned between the lightning and the thunder? We hear it, we see it, we taste it, we feel it, we touch it. Wouldn't it be great if you could be that awake and aware all the time,
yeah,
not just between the lightning and the thunder? And I thought, oh, that's a sign. That's the A with my HWK. That makes Hawk okay.
Wow.
So I came home and changed my name. I got bar mitzvah for my 50th birthday, changed my name. And then when I started meeting people, they weren't talking about my father. They were saying, hey, what a cool name, or what a weird name, or how'd you get that name?
Right, or what's your story?
Or exactly. What's your story?
Yeah.
And then, and so, and about 10 months later, I met Molly Jordan, who we met, and we've been together for 23 years.
Wow.
So this Hawk has made it for life.
That's an incredible story.
Yeah.
Just you personally, aside from all the career stuff, like,
right,
you went 49 years living one way, and you decided, I don't want to do this anymore, or I can't do this anymore, right, and you did something about it. Not a lot of people do something about it.
Well,
that's huge.
Courage is something I believe that everybody's got to have. Most people live in fear.
Mm-hmm.
They're afraid of tasting broccoli when they're a kid.
Anything right? different. Right?
Whatever it is, people are afraid of change and are afraid. And I learned early on, when I was 29 years old, in front of three Academy Award winners, that I had to do something to change the way a movie was going. Dustin Hoffman, we all know who Dustin is, Academy Award winner John Schlesinger, who directed Midnight Cowboy and Darling, and a cinematographer, wonderful cinematographer named Conrad Hall. But I had to go in, it's in the book, I'm not gonna go through the whole story, but how at 29 years old I had the courage to stand up to these three men and change the way a great movie called Marathon Man was made.
Yeah, it's really incredible. And that's, again, not a situation that people are just jumping right and saying, like, I gotta do something different. Some people would just be like, hey, let's keep it going. But what did give you the courage? Without giving everything away, what was that moment like for you?
I had been around the movie business my whole life.
Yeah, your whole life. Hanging around with your dad on set, the whole thing.
And so I thought I knew what I knew about the business. And by the way, I'm still learning.
Mm-hmm.
We all still keep
every
learning.
Day. Yeah.
And so I knew what was wrong. And I decided, you know what? I was brought to Mount Kisco, upstate New York, to make a difference. And there's no point in not telling them what they were doing wrong. And I told them what they were doing wrong, and I told them we had to change. And we stayed on schedule the rest of the movie.
Mm.
75 more days of shooting.
Wow.
And by the way, it turned out to be a great movie. If any of your fans out there haven't seen Marathon Man, it's a terrific movie.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. So why don't we talk about some of the people you've crossed paths with? Why don't we start with Robert Redford, because you've crossed paths with him a bunch, but early on in your career, he was somebody important. So what was the best part of that experience for you?
Well, first of all, I met him in only his second film, so he wasn't Robert Redford.
He was just Robert at that point.
He was Bob, and we threw the football around. We played golf on Sundays, and we were shooting in Mississippi. We had a great time together, and then we came back to Los Angeles. We're back in L.A. He said to me, hey, I bought some land up in Utah, and I want to drive up there this weekend when we finish shooting. You want to drive with me? We'll share the driving. And we'll get up there, we'll spend all day Saturday, all day Sunday, and Sunday night we'll drive back, you can drive back, and I'll sleep, so I'm ready for Monday morning
you're
shooting.
Like, great, thanks, Bob.
Yeah, okay. But I was 19 years old.
Right,
I
you're mean, like, let's do it,
sure,
why not?
Sure, why not? So we get in the car, like 7 o'clock at night, midnight we arrive in Vegas, we eat at all you can eat, and he drove the first 5 hours, so now it's my turn to drive. We're about an hour and a half out of Vegas, heading up to Utah. Totally black, you know, in 1965, not a super highway, but a highway, you know. And all of a sudden, I'm driving and Redford says, get off the main road. And I said, why, Bob? He said, get off the main road. And I'm going, what the hell is going on? I got off the main road, we're on a side road, and we're driving for about a minute or so. He says, turn here. I said, it's a dirt road, Bob. We're going to Utah. He said, turn off here. So I turned off, and I'm on the dirt road. He said, stop. I said, why? He said, stop. And I put my foot on the brake. He jammed the gear shift into park, grabbed the keys, and said, get out. Well, like in a cartoon, my heart was going like this. And I'm looking for a gun, I'm looking for a knife, I'm looking for...
You're thinking, what have I gotten myself into?
Yeah, here? Who is this guy, right? I only knew him like 6-8 weeks.
Right, that's it.
Right? And we get out of the car, and he's on one side of the hood, and I'm on the other. And he looked at me, and I'm thinking, okay, my life is over. And all of a sudden, he just screamed, ah! Really loud for about 45 seconds.
Oh my gosh.
He threw me the keys, he kind of laughed and said, try it. It's really cool. And I went, eh. That's all I could get out.
Yeah, because you're just freaked out about everything that's happening right
out,
now.
I can't believe I didn't pee in my pants. I got back in the car, and he proceeded to tell me about something called the primal scream, which Arthur Janoff had started. And what he said is, sometimes you need to release, to let it all out. And we drove up to Utah. He had just built an A-frame house, and he said, I own all this land, and I'm going to do something with it. Of course, it became Sundance,
the
ski resort and
That's
the film
so cool.
festival and everything else. But this picture here is me in front of 1.3 billion people on the Oscars in 2013. And before I went on stage, people said, how'd you get out there? I said, I didn't know that I could. I said, but I went outside the Dolby Theater, and I did the primal scream. And I came in, and I said to myself, magic time.
Wow.
And I went on, and I went onto the stage, and did it, and I had a ball.
That's an incredible story. I mean, think about where you were as a 19-year-old kid to where you were here, and those two people connect in that sense.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
So when you think about Redford, what has impressed you most about his career over the years?
He's a fine actor. He's a fine director, Academy Award winning director. He cares about the environment. Mm. He cares about people. And he cares about the land. And he always has. And so I'm really proud to know him. He's one of those, I've worked with a lot of actors, a lot of actresses. He's a real pro. He knows. There are several that are really good actors, and then there's the ones that are the geniuses. You know, like
he's
there's
in that
certainly
pantheon up here.
Yeah, he's up there. He's
really
up there
cool.
with Streisand and Edward Norton, and Warren Beatty, and certain people that you just know that there's something a little more.
What's that something for Ed Norton? Why do you put him up there as well?
Well, I was lucky enough to produce his first film, Primal Fear.
Yep.
And he was, I don't know if it's in the book, but there's a great story about when he came out to test and I first met him. Deb Aquila, our great casting director at Paramount at the time, met 2,500 people and brought him and one other guy out to test. And when I went in to meet him before the test, he kind of stuttered, and he was from West Virginia, and he was a really sweet kid. And we went on stage, and he met Richard Gere and Greg Hoblit, our terrific director, and my partner, Gary Lucchesi. And he started to do a couple of the scenes where he plays kind of a sweet, kind of stuttering kid from West Virginia. And then there's a scene in the movie where he turns from this sweet little kid to his other personality, to this killer. And when he did that scene, all of us behind the video camera went, oh my God, this guy's unbelievable. And when we cut the camera, Richard Gere turned to us, and Edward was behind him, and he couldn't see, and Richard went, whoa, like that. And we knew we had someone who we got to discover.
That's amazing. Some,
I mean, it's like like an American Idol or a Voice or something where all of a sudden there's somebody that much better than everybody else. And you know you know, in the tryouts, if you're watching those shows,
you can sense who's going to be the one.
Maybe that one or that one, but they're way above everybody else, and that was Edward, and still is.
Yeah, he's still
doing
it.
He's got Motherless Brooklyn.
Yeah, gotta check it out.
It's a brilliant performance.
Yeah, same sort of thing where he's going into a whole different type of character.
Yeah, right.
That's really cool.
Right. So Natalie Wood, I want to tell you one, Natalie,
sure. Go for
because
it.
A lot of actors ask me, you know, how do you get what's going on with someone like Natalie
sure.
Wood? So I'm 19 years old. I'm down in Mississippi, and one of my jobs, is to go get Natalie Wood from the trailer. And so there's where you're shooting, and then there's what we call base camp, mm-hmm. right? And they said, go get Natalie Wood. It was her first day of shooting. So I run. People walked. I ran. I was 19.
You were going for it.
Yeah, I ran to her trailer, and who wasn't in love with Natalie Wood? Mm-hmm. Splendor in the Grass, West Side Story.
Yeah, she was at that point.
Oh, phew. And I knocked on the door, and she said, yes. And I said, we're ready for you. And she said, oh, I'll be out in a few minutes. And I said, like an idiot 19-year-old, oh, well, James Wong Howe, 2 Oscars for cinematography. James Wong Howe, our cinematographer, said the light is perfect. Opened the door, and she looked, and she came out, and she took my arm, and we walked up to the set. When she got on the set, everybody said, how did you get Natalie Wood out of her trailer? She never comes out of her trailer. And I said, I told her that the light was perfect. Mm. I've used that with every actor to get them out of the trailer for my entire career.
It's a good one to go for.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Because you don't want to be the reason that you mess something up like that, right?
But experience is important in life. You learn something. I'm constantly learning. If I hadn't learned that at 19, who knows if I would have ever been able to get any of those people out of the trailer, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So you've done all these different movies in your career. I love the Wayne's World franchise. I mean, that must have been a really special moment for you. What are some things we don't know about that whole experience? What would surprise people about those movies?
Well, I was with Mike last night, actually.
Awesome.
And Mike he's a genius, and he's very shy. Hmm. And I think probably a lot of comics are maybe introverted, but that's where they get it out.
Right.
But he's shy, and I sent him the book digitally very early. Because I said, hey, Mike, I just wrote a book. Would you mind reading it for me? And if you like it, you know, maybe give me a quote. Mm-hmm. I sent it at 3:00 in the afternoon, New York time. At 7:00 in the morning, LA time, the next day, he wrote me back and said, I read the whole thing.
Wow.
He said, here's your quote. It's a great quote. And I mean, I couldn't believe.
That's cool.
And he said, there are no books like this. Mm. And it was like, wow, Mike Myers said that. So we're on the set of Wayne's World, mm-hmm. and we're doing the scene where the blue pacer is parked because there's a cop, the guy from Terminator 2, Robert Patrick, and he walks up to the like this, right, to the thing. Mm-hmm. And my son Robbie, who was 12 at the time, a long time ago, mm-hmm. I brought him to the set because it was a Friday night, and he's standing with me and Penelope Spheris, the director, and I think the Turners, who wrote it with Mike Myers, who went on to do Third Rock from mm-hmm. the Sun and a lot of other stuff. So in rehearsal, Patrick comes up and leans down to Mike Myers and says, you were speeding. And my 12-year-old son just out loud goes, well, that's not funny.
Oh, no.
You bring your kid to the set, right?
And you've been that kid on the set, too.
Right. But I always knew to keep my mouth
shut up. Yeah.
Right. So Mike leaned out of the pacer back towards the camera and said, why, Robbie? Why isn't it funny? Well, he said, because the cop had a Polaroid and said, have you seen this boy? That was what the cop said in Terminator 2. So Mike said, he's right. Let's get a Polaroid picture. And they took a picture of Robbie.
Oh my god.
And
gosh.
So Robbie is in Wayne's World.
That's amazing.
And it and the first time I went with Robbie to see the movie, got huge laughs. And he hit me. He said, I know, Dad, I know.
You're so like, I've been doing this thing for a while, but my 12-year-old son knew better than that.
Right. And that's a great Wayne's World moment for
me. That's really cool.
Yes.
So I mentioned a couple projects you've done.
Sure.
Who are some other people you've worked with or other movies that really stick out and all the ones you've done?
Well, The Way We Were, I mean, with Streisand, and a movie that's not very popular, wasn't very popular, but I got to do a movie with Barbara called Up the Sandbox, and we went to Africa.
Oh, wow.
To shoot a fantasy sequence. So we were in Kenya, and we went to a Samburu village. Samburu are a cousin to the Maasai. Mm-hmm. They have red clay, they have beautiful, beautiful jewelry and the things and the, all that stuff. And we went out there to rehearse the day before we started to shoot there. And Barbara came with us. And there were little kids, and the women were singing. They didn't know who Barbara Streisand was, but Barbara got down on the ground with them and started singing. And the crew, I mean, we were like, are you kidding
me? Oh my gosh.
It was one of the most wonderful things you've ever seen, because celebrities really have to be on when they're in front of people, mm-hmm. and they get very little private time when they're running around promoting a movie or even trying to go to
Starbucks,
Bloomingdale's or whatever. Yeah. You know, that it's really hard for them. Yeah. So in Africa, she was absolutely free to be herself. And it was really a very special moment.
That's really cool.
So it's a good story.
Yeah, it's a great story. So you've done all these movies, you've led the Academy. When you think about movies today, what do you think about the culture that we have right now? Do you like the way things are going? Are you bothered by it? I mean, you're an old school cat with all this stuff, so what do you think?
Yeah, I wish there were more what I call, you know, Academy-worthy movies that were playing in movie theaters right now, because I'm someone who loves to go to the movies. I don't like to watch screeners, and
to do the whole experience.
I like the experience. Yeah. I want to go in, and I want to buy the popcorn. Yeah. I want to sit in the room. I want to laugh with everybody else. I want to be scared with everybody else. And I want to be absolutely riveted by something. And so franchises are okay, because it keeps people going to the movie theaters.
Sure.
So that's great, but I want them to go to the other movies as well, and I'm hoping that some movies that a few of the studios and a few of the independents are allowing to play in movie theaters longer than right away they're being streamed.
Just a couple of weeks.
I don't know anybody who's 16 to 40 who wants to go on a date and, hey, come back to my apartment and let's sit in front of a television.
Sit in front of a little iPhone.
Or an iPhone, right? I want to go out.
Yeah.
I want to take my date or my partner or whatever it is. Let's walk down the street. Let's be with people. Let's have a great meal. Let's go. And movies are still the cheapest form of entertainment.
Absolutely.
If you try and go to Broadway, go to a ball game, basketball, football, baseball, forget it.
No.
It still costs less than anything else.
That's a good point. Yeah.
So, you know, that's a great place, and you get the experience. So I'm hoping that some of the great filmmakers that are making films for the streamers now, people will go, wow, that's cool. I'd like to see that on a big screen. And maybe people will be swayed and call in or write in or whatever and say, hey, how do I see that movie on a big screen in a movie theater? Because, you know, I want to see Scorsese's movie. I don't want to see it on television.
Mm-hmm.
Are you kidding? He filmed it for the big screen. Let's see it in movie theaters.
And that's why it's really interesting that The Irishman will have 3 weeks in theaters before it goes to Netflix, but at least you do have those 3 weeks.
Yeah, but it's only like in a couple of theaters in each town. It's not that many towns.
Yeah.
So, you know, I wish it was playing longer. And I'm a believer of everybody having a level playing field.
Mm-hmm.
So if all the other studios are having a window between the time it's in a theater and when it's going to be on television or being streamed, why should one company be able to have a different amount of time?
Yeah, that's a fair
point.
You
know, it's just, you know, let's all play on
same set of rules.
Right, same set of rules.
Yeah. I saw Once Upon a Time in Hollywood in theaters, and great movie to see in theaters.
Oh, cool.
And it was unbelievable. And especially the last 30 minutes, I'm laughing with the whole rest of the people in there.
Right.
And that was something I wouldn't have had otherwise.
Oh. Listen, Roma.
Yeah.
Roma last year, I saw in a movie theater.
I should have saw that in a theater. And I saw it on Netflix, and it was beautifully made.
I had friends in the Academy who said, I turned it off after 20 minutes. Yeah. Oh my God, sitting at home trying to, you know.
It was a hard one to watch at home, but if you'd watched it in theaters, I'm sure it was a totally different experience.
It was fantastic in theaters. Yeah. It should have played enough so that everybody in the Academy and everybody else who wanted to see it could see it in a movie theater. Mm.
Yeah, no doubt. So when people check out your book, what are some big thoughts you want them to have about you as a man and the industry itself?
I have a few kind of tenets. Mm-hmm. Number one, have fun.
That's a good one. That's
if you're not having fun, boy, you better try and find out something quick to do, something else. Number two, do something that matters. Mm. You know, people go, you made Wayne's World. Wayne's World doesn't matter. Yeah, it does.
It does.
Because
we're
people
still
have been laughing
yep.
and having a great time. And laughter is important. Have courage. Don't live in fear. We talked about that. And live your dream. Not your parents' dream for you, not your friend or your partner or your sister or your brother's dream for you, but look inside yourself and say, what do I really want to do? Like I asked you, what do you want to be doing in 5 years? What is your dream? My oldest son's about to be 50. Mm. But he always wanted to be a rock star, and for his 50th birthday, he's taking over a bar in a place called Del Mar, California, and he's hired a backup musicians, and he's going to sing 8 songs.
That's awesome.
He doesn't have a great voice.
Hey, good for him.
But
for
you
doing
know what?
It, right?
He said, for my 50th birthday, I'm going to just sing. And he's got, you know, like 100 friends in a small bar, and I'm flying back there at the end of the week, and we're going to have a ball. And he's doing what he dreamed of doing.
That's amazing. Clearly, 50th birthdays are a big deal.
Yeah, I guess so. I guess so.
Hawk, thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
Absolute pleasure.
I enjoyed it.
Check this man's book out, Magic Time. You won't be disappointed. For Hawk, I'm DJ. See you next time.
Take care.
Let's sit down.